break started to read those three papers. Everybody read them? Yeah, Alan did. He's nodding his head. All right, so we can start quickly with those. So I think the first thing is, does anybody have questions about the papers? So we already went over them. Pretty straightforward? Yeah? Okay. If there's no questions, I'm going to go ahead and jump in. So I don't think we need to go over them again. Anybody want to go over them again? Yes? Yeah.
So in that paper, like 2006,
yeah.
Is it like information is occurring due to elements, low-frequency stimulation that recruits may...
So you're asking about the 2006 paper?
Yeah.
Let me pull it up. Been here in a while, I don't know what I'm doing. All right, here we go. This computer is unbelievably slow. All right, so which figure are you asking about in particular, or just a general question? Mostly what?
High-frequency stimulation.
Okay. So let's go back to kind of the point of doing these experiments in the first place. So if you recall that when you stimulate nociceptors naturally, because they have broad action potentials, they don't fire at very high frequency. So their normal firing frequency is somewhere between maybe 1 and 10 hertz, okay? So if you look at the entire LTP literature and also look at the long-term depression literature, what you'll see is that the normal firing frequency of nociceptors with natural stimulation, so with inflammatory stimulation, is low frequency. So what you would imagine is there's happy connections in the spinal cord. What you would actually see is long-term depression and not long-term potentiation, or maybe just nothing because it falls kind of in between the long-term depression frequency and the long-term potentiation frequency. But in most experiments and most other brain regions, if you're going to stimulate induced LTP, you're going to stimulate at 50 to 100 hertz, which is probably beyond the firing frequency that nociceptors will ever fire under physiological conditions. So the real point of doing these experiments, which are shown in figure 2, are to try to figure out if that natural firing frequency of nociceptors can induce LTP in the spinal cord at all. And what they find is that while high-frequency stimulation, which for this particular synapse is non-natural because the neurons don't normally fire at that frequency, that you can see LTP in a subset of the neurons, right? But in the neurons that project to the periaqueductal gray, so that's a subset of these lamina 1 projection neurons, high-frequency stimulation doesn't cause LTP. So that's there. Great, my battery's dead. But in B, right? So high frequency stimulation doesn't cause LTP, but low frequency stimulation does. And essentially, the whole point of the rest of this paper. So the low frequency stimulation, the whole rationale for using that is to like mimic inflammation, but without actually producing inflammation. So for most of this paper, they don't actually produce any inflammation at all. They're just stimulating the neurons. When they do finally cause some inflammation, they use capsaicin and formalin. And the reason that they do that is because over probably 2 decades before they did this experiment, other people have shown that if you inject capsaicin or formalin with capsaicin in both animals and human beings, that the nociceptors fire at a frequency that's consistent with low frequency stimulation. And that does, in fact, induce LTP. So you would imagine in most situations where either an animal or a human being has activation of their nociceptors for a fairly long duration of time, but not that terribly long, so on the order of minutes, that it can induce LTP. And in fact, I think we talked about this paper at the start of the class, but it'll come up again in the fourth part of the class. There's this German group that does studies in humans where they put a stimulating electrode on people's legs or their back or their arms, and they actually stimulate at this frequency, low frequency stimulation, and then they look at what they call perceptual ATP. So basically, like, they use a von Frey filament and they touch the person in the area where they stimulate, and before they stimulate, they usually are like, that's not painful at all. And then after the stimulation, it becomes painful, right? So you get LTP. It's perceptual LTP because they're not actually recording the synapses. But as you do this over many hours, and even some days or months, they've done these studies now, in most people, they see LTP. Perceptual LTP, it lasts for about 6 to 24 hours. But there's some subset of people that they do it to where even a month later, it doesn't go away, right? So I think one of the real big questions that you might ask based on these existing papers is, you know, how long does this really last? And how relevant is it to pain chronification, which is still a pretty open question. It's a very difficult question to address because, number one, it's hard to do electrophysiology experiments that last that long. And number two, if you know that some stimulation protocol is likely to cause people to have pain for a month or more in a volunteer study, your institutional review board is very likely to tell you, well, that first study you did is very interesting, but you're not doing these studies anymore because this is now in the area of not being ethical. So that's an issue to try to study. Okay. Any other questions about the papers? Yes?
Is the, just looking at that same figure, you see the
this one?
Yeah, the same
figure. Yeah.
The low frequency stimulation causes the LTP and the perioperative upgrade.
So it's in the neurons that project to the perioperative upgrade. So they're the spinal dorsal horn neurons and they project there. But yeah.
Yeah, so is it, but you don't see it in the parabrachial projection, and the neurons project to parabrachial. So is it specific to a certain subset of receptors, or is that just kind of?
So as far as we know at this point, the nociceptors that connect to that, the parabrachial projection neurons and the PAG are very similar. So it's mostly the peptidergic subset. It could be that there's inner neurons that have converging inputs from the IB4 neurons that go into lamina 2, and that's what causes what you see, the difference between these two, but I'm not aware of anybody that has studied that in detail to give an answer to the question. It's a great question. There clearly is something different between the parabrachial neurons and the PAG projecting neurons. But nobody knows what the difference is, so it's a great research question. That's one of the neat things about papers like this, is oftentimes there's a really interesting finding. So in this one, the really interesting finding is that low frequency stimulation can actually induce LTP in some synapses, right? So that is very, very uncommon. But it fits with the physiology here. But the reason why it happens in one subset of neurons, but not in the others, it's mysterious. And this paper was published in 2006, right? So it was 12 years ago. And I've still not seen anybody able to answer that question necessarily. So it's a good question. question, continues to be a good question. So answer to it, yes?
Do you personally feel that genome sequencing in the near future could predict quantification of pain, like you would be able to find factors in person from the doctor or something?
So the question was, can you use sequencing technology to try to make predictions about why one set of neurons responds in one way and not another one? So that's actually what a lot of people are trying to do now. So I wouldn't say that they're doing genomic sequencing. So you know, it's very likely that the DNA from one cell to another in these populations is very close to identical, if not identical. Although there have been some reports on mutations and how they can lead to differences in plasticity in neurons, but my guess would be they're still very similar. So the way that people are actually trying to address the kind of question that you just asked is using RNA sequencing technology. So how many of you guys have heard of single cell RNA sequencing? All the people that work in my lab. Okay, a couple that don't work in my lab. All right, cool. So this is a technology that basically what you do is you isolate single cells using a variety of different techniques, and there's all kinds of new techniques that are coming on board to do this. And you take all the RNA from the cells and you sequence it, okay? So it tells you basically what are all the genes that are expressed in that particular cell, right? So one way that you could address this question is you could, for instance, you could back label from the PAG and the parabrachial nucleus, and in one set of animals maybe get the parabrachial, and another set of animals get the PAG subset, okay? And you can isolate those cells, and you can sequence them. And one hypothesis you might have is that NMDA receptor signaling downstream factors would be very high in the PAG neurons because they seem to be able to get this very robust LTP just from a little bit of NMDA receptor stimulation, whereas in the other ones you might expect that you wouldn't see that. That's just a hypothesis, but the beauty of RNA sequencing is that it's completely unbiased, so you know it's not a hypothesis-based technique. You're not choosing a subset of genes, you actually are sequencing everything that's there, or close to everything that's there, so it's unbiased in that regard. It's a great hypothesis-generating tool. So what bioinformaticists, people like Andy, who works in my lab, have done with this kind of stuff is that they can take these very large data sets that you generate, and then there's a variety of different analysis tools, or sometimes people build their own analysis tools to try to understand how one cell is different from another, so that you can then create a hypothesis that you can test, but that's based on a large amount of very valuable information. So there have been a large number of papers come out in the last 2 years in the pain field about single cell sequencing in the dorsal root ganglion and in the spinal cord. And basically, the DRG, there's way more than there is for spinal cord right now, but what that is telling us is that these populations that we talk about, you know, like the peptidergic, the non-peptidergic, and the large diameter A fibers, they're actually a lot more nuanced than that. That there are sub-classes within those that have very distinct patterns of receptors, et cetera, that are found in them. And there have been some recent papers in the spinal cord where they've looked at lamina 1 versus lamina 2 and 3 versus lamina 5 neurons, and they also were quite distinct. So neurons are very diverse. Many cell types are very diverse, but neurons seem to be especially diverse. And I think the question that you asked, if I was going to try to approach the question you asked first, right, the technique I would use is what you were talking about, right? So I would try to segregate those cells. I would do sequencing or some similar type of technique. And then I would use that to generate a hypothesis, knowing what we already know about their physiology, to try to discover what's actually different about them. The problem then becomes, how similar is it from one species to another, right? And that often is a very hard thing to know, because what's beautiful about the mouse system is that the genetic tools have proliferated so incredibly that we have things that we can use to basically label any cell type that we want, and that enables this kind of single cell sequencing. But if we were going to human spinal cord, which we could get from an organ donor, nobody would have any idea even where to start, really. Because number one, there's no genetic tracers, you can't do any back labels. So one of the things that I think the mouse, what's gonna change really dramatically is the mouse technology is gonna enable this kind of explosion in big data that will enable then researchers 5 to 10 years from now, or maybe even faster, to start using the tissues that are available from humans, either through surgeries that are happening. I mean, surgical techniques on the nervous system are advancing a lot, but also from organ donor networks. So more and more people, when they sign up to be organ donors, they also sign up to give their nervous system away to science, which is something I will enthusiastically have enthusiastically signed up for. I don't hope to become an organ donor soon, but we will all die eventually, and our nervous systems, if you're going to give up your organs, might as well give up your nervous system too, right? So it's a really growing resource, and as nervous system disorders continue to be like the big thing that we just can't treat, and more people become aware of it, our ability to do this kind of stuff continues to grow. So it's a really exciting time to be able to do that. Right, Andy? Yeah, he agrees enthusiastically as normal. All right, any other questions about the papers? All right, so what we will do is on Thursday, at the end of the lecture, we're gonna transition to talking about this paper, which is the fourth one in this series of papers from the Sankulo lab. And this one is about how glia contribute to LTP in the spinal cord. So what we'll start on today is on disinhibition and touch evoke pain. We'll wrap that up on Thursday, and then we'll get into this paper a little bit. And then the following week, on Tuesday, Blaine Jacobs, who's a postdoc in my lab, is gonna come in and give you guys the lecture on glia, okay? And then you'll have your test, the third test in the course starting on Wednesday, okay? So if you haven't already signed up for the exam, please make sure you do that. Yes? Maybe it's Thursday. The window can be flexible though, so like if it's good for you, if you guys want me to open the window so it starts on Wednesday, I can do that. Okay? But yeah, I think it starts on Thursday. All right. So we'll talk about this. I'll post this on e-learning today, and then we'll talk about it on Thursday after we finish the lecture. Oh, that was already over. Okay. All right. So, what's going on with this thing? Oh, the laser doesn't work because I had it off. Yeah, it does work. Okay. The absent-minded professor today. All right. So. What we're going to talk about today is touch-evoked pain. So, touch-evoked pain, or mechanical allodynia, is a very prominent feature of many types of chronic pain, in particular, neuropathic pain. Okay, and this particular type of pain really drives patients pretty nuts. Because lots of things that they encounter in their daily life now cause them pain basically constantly. And that can be as simple as just wearing clothes, right? So people that have PHN, postherpetic neuralgia, which thankfully is starting to go away because we have vaccines now for that, but it still affects a fairly large portion of the population. Most of these people get it in their flank somewhere, and just the act, the wearing of a shirt, which everybody does on a daily basis, becomes painful, right? So it's miserable, and people very badly want it to go away. The other thing that's interesting about touch-evoked pain, though, is it's a big mystery from neuroscience, right? We know that we have these labeled lines, right? We have nociceptive neurons, we have non-nociceptive neurons, and their anatomy is segregated. We've spent two big portions of this course talking about that. You have separate neurons that are dedicated to pain in the peripheral nervous system. They come into the spinal cord in different areas. They send separate projections to the brain. So how is it that the A-beta fiber input can suddenly, under certain circumstances, gain access to the pain channel, Okay, so this has been a big mystery to neuroscientists and a very robust area of research for a long time, because it's just really interesting, right? People want to understand this problem. So there have been a lot of ideas that they mostly originated with this theory, the gate control theory from Melzack and Wall, that again was published in 1965, so a long time ago, but this was really the event that launched modern pain neurobiology, along with Ed Perl's discovery of nociceptors. I just want to highlight one thing about this idea. It was based on inhibitory and excitatory neurotransmitters, and they knew at the time that the major excitatory neurotransmitter was glutamate, and that GABA was a major inhibitory neurotransmitter. Most of the receptors actually at this time were not known. Okay, so like the difference between NMDA and AMPA receptors was not known. But they had these neurotransmitters, positive and negative neurotransmitters here. But there's one fundamental mistake in the theory, which you guys can probably all grasp, either because I've already talked about it before or because it's kind of obvious. Right? You have a C-fiber neuron, and you have it releasing two different kinds of neurotransmitters in two different places. And there are very few, if any, examples of neurons that do this, that would release GABA at one synapse and glutamate at another synapse. So there are many things that are wrong with this theory, actually, right? But this is one of the things that's just fundamentally wrong about it. But the key is that the concept was very important. It led to a bunch of testable hypotheses and has now led to, I think, what's a pretty good theoretical understanding about how allodynia works. And the principle of allodynia, or this mixing up of touch and pain pathway, really boils down to the way inhibition works in the spinal cord and to this concept of disinhibition, or the loss of inhibition. All right, so that's what we're going to talk about in the next two lectures. So we're going to go over two kind of competing ideas about how this works. Okay? All right. So, first of all, we still use this term gate control. We still use it mostly in deference to the fact that this concept really was, again, the birth of modern pain neurobiology. And it's a kind of guiding principle that people have used to generate hypotheses. And it's been a very successful guiding principle, because it's led to lots of new research and better understanding about how the sensory nervous system work. But you can essentially boil it down into two categories of how this kind of mix-up of these pathways can happen. One of them is that it happens through a peripherally mediated mechanism. It still involves the central nervous system, but it's all presynaptic, okay? So basically, what's happening is that C fibers get activated presynaptically by GABAergic interneurons in the dorsal horn. Okay, so remember that we talked about how A beta fibers come in and form a synapse in lamina 3, right? Most of those A beta fibers synapse on inhibitory interneurons, and many of those inhibitory neurons actually project into the superficial lamina of the spinal cord. So the idea is actually pretty simple. And that is that when you have A-beta fibers activate these GABAergic interneurons, under most circumstances, they make presynaptic connections with C-fibers, okay, and they inhibit them. So this goes back to this principle that we've talked about several times in this class, and that's that we all have a reflex that we do if we injure ourselves acutely. If you hit your hand with a hammer, you stub your toe, whatever, you curse first, and then you rub the affected area, right? And you do that for a good reason. That causes this gate control mechanism to kick in. And those A-beta fibers that synapse that you're stimulating when you rub your finger, if you just hit your finger, they stimulate the A-beta fibers, they activate those GABAergic neurons, and they at least theoretically inhibit the C-fibers through a presynaptic mechanism, okay? So that pain from the C-fibers, you're blocking their ability to release neurotransmitter by inhibiting them at the presynaptic terminal, okay? If you remember back to the way that we talked about norepinephrine working, coming from the brain, it's basically the same concept, right? The norepinephrine neurons send down their projections from the brain into the spinal cord, they release norepinephrine, and the norepinephrine binds to alpha-2 receptors that are presynaptic on the C-fibers. Same type of idea, right? So you can get it two different ways. You can get one of it by turning on descending inhibition from your brain. Another way you can do it is just activating these intrinsic spinal cord circuits by stimulating A beta fibers, right? The problem with this is pretty clear. If you have neuropathic pain, this doesn't work anymore, okay? So why does it change? Why does A beta stimulation go from being pain inhibitory to pain activating, right? So I'm gonna start off by talking about ideas about how this works. So we'll basically make it through this theory, and then on Thursday, we'll start talking about the one that doesn't really involve presynaptic stuff. It's just a central change in efficacy of GABAergic inhibition, right? But we're gonna have to talk about how the GABAergic system works in order to talk about both of these. So today, we'll focus on that and the presynaptic. All right, so this is a diagram that came from Fernando Severo and Ginny Laird and was published in 2003. So if I'm going to tell you guys a story, I have to tell you a story about myself as well, because I actually worked on this theory for 3 years when I was a postdoc. I did my postdoc with this guy, Fernando Severo, and I decided to do my postdoc with him because I thought this was an amazing idea and I wanted to work on it. Okay, so I was doing my PhD in Ken Hargreaves' lab in San Antonio, studying cannabinoid pharmacology, trying to decide what I wanted to do with my scientific career. And I had always been very intrigued by this mixing up of sensory systems and how it happens. And Fernando had just proposed this new idea, which I'll tell you guys about in a couple of minutes, and had published this very intriguing figure here. And I wanted to go to his lab to work on it. So I did go to his lab, I did work on it, and I'll tell you what our results were and what I think about this idea at the end of the lecture today. All right, so what Fernando and Ginny, and these guys are married, okay? So they're a very well-known scientific couple in the pain field. I actually had the intention of working with Ginny and not Fernando, but I worked with Fernando and not Ginny, because Ginny became the director of analgesia development at AstraZeneca in Montreal, and she was not taking postdocs anymore. Postdocs were way below her pay grade at her job at AstraZeneca. She couldn't be bothered by trying to train somebody like me. But Fernando was still a professor at McGill University, so it worked out. But I didn't get to work with Ginny. All right, so the idea here is pretty simple. It's basically what I just told you, okay? So you have A beta fibers, you have C fibers, okay, and you have interneurons that connect to these guys, okay? So this is not drawn in an anatomically correct fashion, but it gets the point across, all right? So if you get hurt and your C fibers become active, your A beta fibers can be stimulated by you rubbing your hand, right? And that activates these interneurons that release GABA. GABA acts presynaptically on these C fibers, okay? But there's something very interesting that happens when you put GABA on sensory neurons. So you guys have probably already learned about GABA, and it's the major inhibitory neurotransmitter in the brain, and it causes hyperpolarization, right? Okay, so GABA does that in most circuits in the brain in adulthood. But is GABA an inhibitory neurotransmitter or an excitatory neurotransmitter during very early development? Does anybody already know this? It's excitatory, right? So there's one type of neuron, there's more than one, but there's one major type of neuron that in adulthood is actually excited, and by excited I mean depolarized by GABA. And those are dorsal root ganglia. So they actually never show hyperpolarization if you expose them to GABA. And the reason for that is because they manage their intracellular chloride concentrations differently than most other cells do. And I'll go through that in detail in the coming slides, okay? So what GABA does when you put it on sensory neurons is it causes what's called primary afferent depolarization. This was actually described way back in the 1950s, okay? So this is one of the really, really early kind of electrophysiological findings in the spinal cord. So this primary afferent depolarization is not enough to cause excitation of these neurons. What it does is it creates what's called a shunting inhibition. Okay, so I'll go into the details of why that's the case in coming slides, but even though it's mildly depolarizing, it's still inhibitory. Okay, it's not big enough to get you to produce action potentials. So that's this part, okay, the top up here. So what happens after injury? So, and this was the continuation of this figure that Fernando and Ginny published in 2003. So the hypothesis here was that inflammation causes these C fibers to change the way that they respond to GABA, such that the primary afferent depolarization would get bigger, and instead of the GABA causing this small depolarization, it would cause a very large depolarization above action potential threshold. And now, the result of that is that when you activate A beta fibers, it acts on these GABAergic neurons in the same way that it did before. But when these things release GABA, the physiological response in the C fiber is fundamentally different. So now you get an even bigger depolarization. It no longer causes shunting inhibition, but it now causes action potential generation. So what you get is a signal that goes to these nociceptor specific neurons in the spinal cord. So you used to be inhibiting them, now you're activating them by A beta stimulation. And it also causes antidromic firing and neurogenic inflammation. This is another thing that can be seen in people that have neuropathic pain, is if you brush an area too much, so you give it gentle stimulation, it will actually start to show some inflammation. Okay? So we call that neurogenic inflammation. And it's weird because it's driven by A-beta fibers, right? But this theory that was proposed by Jenny and Fernando did a really nice job of potentially explaining both of these findings, right? Why does A-beta fiber stimulation cause pain? And number two, why can you get neurogenic inflammation from this kind of stimulation, okay? All right, so now fast forward some time to 2014, I think, published this. So this is actually a review that Kai Kayla and I published in Nature Reviews Neuroscience a couple years ago. And it shows basically the same thing. Okay, so before injury, you get a nice inhibition, but it's due to this small depolarization. The reason for that is because of these cotransporters, which we'll get into in the coming slides. But with injury, this changes, and instead of a small depolarization, you get a big depolarization, and it basically occurs because the neuron changes the way it handles chloride. Okay, so this cotransporter that's here under normal circumstances is importing chloride, but when you have injury, it can import really a lot of chloride, so the intracellular chloride concentration goes very high, and that's the driver for this big depolarization. Right. So the next like 10 slides, I'm going to explain why that's the case. So how do neurons handle chloride? What are the chloride cotransporters? And what is the consequences of these things changing their performance, okay? So first of all, the only real major chloride channels that are found in the nervous system are either GABA receptors, GABA-A receptors, or glycine receptors. There are also the enoctamines, but we're not gonna talk about them in any detail, okay? So for the purposes of our class, the major chloride channels are the GABA receptors and the glycine receptors. Okay, so we talk about them as almost always being inhibitory, but in fact that's not the case. So if anybody knows anything about development, which you guys clearly do, because almost all of you answered that question with this excitatory, during early development, GABA is and glycine for that matter can be excitatory, and in fact that plays a really important role in circuit development in the brain, but it switches and then becomes inhibitory, okay? But there are certain situations where it's either excitatory all the time, like in the dorsal root ganglion, or pathologies like neurodegeneration and neuropathic pain, where it can change from being inhibitory to excitatory. And we call that disinhibition. So what causes all this? And basically, it all boils down to chloride, okay? So the next slide is what we're gonna talk about. All right, so first of all, neurons and all other cells in your body regulate their intracellular chloride concentrations very tightly. And they do this basically through two mechanisms. One mechanism can be to import chloride, and for that they use these chloride importer transporters, which are shown right here. So those are the sodium potassium chloride co-transporters, and these all work in the same way. They import one molecule of sodium, one molecule of potassium, and two molecules of chloride, right? So they're electro-neutral. They basically work secondary to the sodium-potassium ATPase. And when they're active, they import chloride, right? So these guys are what we often refer to as chloride accumulators. So when they're active, they're going to raise the intracellular chloride concentration. But we also have these so-called potassium chloride co-transporters. And these work in the opposite fashion. They don't accumulate chloride, but they extrude chloride, right? So these we call the KCCs. So these are the NKCs, and these are called the KCCs. And these guys export one potassium molecule and one chloride molecule, so they're extruders, right? So these two things counterbalance each other. We're not gonna talk about these very much at all, but it is interesting to note that some of the neurotransmitter receptor transporters also move ions. And in fact, you can record the electrophysiological activity of these because they also move ions. All right, so we've talked already several times about how there's a developmental switch. So in early life of the nervous system, chloride is depolarizing, but it becomes hyperpolarizing. So how does that happen? This is explained in this slide, okay? So basically we have birth here, and then up to about postnatal day 7 and then 14 in rodents, okay? So this is in mice or rats. So it's about the same in both mice and rats. All right, so in these immature neurons, so right about the time of birth, the intracellular chloride concentration is shown here on the y-axis. The intracellular chloride concentration is very high, okay? So it's as high as 50 millimolar, usually closer to about 40 millimolar. And the reason for this is very simple, actually. The expression level for the sodium potassium 2-chloride co-transporter is very high, okay? So there's a lot of chloride accumulation happening. And KCC2, which is the major chloride extruder in the nervous system, is not expressed very much at all, okay? So under early, in immature neurons, there's very, very little KCC expression. So there's two isoforms of these transporters that are the most important. NKCC1 for the sodium potassium 2-chloride, and KCC2 for the KCCs, okay? So for the rest of the class today, we're just gonna talk about NKCC1 and KCC2. NKCC1 is the thing that is gonna accumulate chloride if it's happening. KCC2 is the one that's extruding chloride if it's happening, okay? So in development, around the time of birth or in humans during the first and second trimesters, there's a lot of NKCC1 expression and hardly any KCC2 expression. That causes there to be a very high intracellular chloride concentration, and therefore when you open these channels, you get a depolarization. Right. What happens at about day 7 in rodents and about the start of the third trimester in humans is that KCC2 expression starts to take off, and that shifts the balance completely. So you go from chloride accumulation to chloride extrusion, and you drop the intracellular chloride concentration down to about 10 millimolar. Right? And what that causes is a very, very robust chloride influx when you open these channels and hyperpolarization, right? So what could theoretically happen is in the adulthood, you could have neurons that either don't ever turn on KCC2 expression, or KCC2 expression could be turned off by some kind of injury or something like that, right? So for dorsal root ganglion neurons, in fact, KCC2 expression never turns on. So dorsal root ganglion neurons, nociceptors and large diameter neurons, they have NKCC1 expression, and they always have high intracellular chloride concentration. That's why when you open a chloride channel on those neurons, you always get depolarization, okay? Because because rather than chloride coming into the cell, chloride leaves the cell. So a negative charge leaving the cell is going to cause depolarization, right? A negative charge entering the cell would cause hyperpolarization. Yes?
Is there a disorder where KCC2 is inactive?
Yeah, so we'll, that'll be pretty much the entire basis of the lecture on Thursday in the context of neuropathic pain, number one. But there are also some other disorders where this seems to occur, and the best example by far is epilepsy, which I'll also talk a little bit about because the person that I wrote that review with, Kai Kayla, he's spent his life studying this in epilepsy. He was actually the person that discovered this developmental shift, number one. So he's in Finland at the University of Helsinki. So he discovered this developmental shift, and he studied this in the context of epilepsy for essentially his entire career. So there's very compelling evidence that the loss of KCC2 function can play a really key role in epileptogenesis and other seizure disorders. There are a lot of people also that are working on this in the autism area now because there's some suggestions that KCC2 expression may underlie some of the features of autism spectrum disorders. I know a lot less about that because I'm not an autism expert.
There's lots of people that are working on that.
All right, so this is actually showing you exactly what we just talked about. Okay, so this is a slide from one of Kai Kayla's previous reviews. So basically what they're doing here is using BDNF and exposing it to an adult slice of hippocampus. And what this does is creates epileptiform discharges, okay? And what he's showing here is that if you take this slice and record the GABA reversal potential, either with or without BDNF, you get a big change. So let's first go through the electrophysiology and then talk about the BDNF part, okay? So this is a current voltage plot, okay? So an IV plot. If you guys have not taken neurophysiology yet, you'll get a lot of these when you take neurophysiology. If you have taken neurophysiology, hopefully you already understand this graph, but let's go through it, okay? All right, so this is the amplitude of the current. On this side, we have hyperpolarization, okay? On this side, we have depolarization. Sorry, that's wrong. This side is hyperpolarization. This side is depolarization, okay? So here is the reversal potential for GABA, okay? So if you're on this side of the reversal potential, and here's the resting membrane potential, okay? So notice this is basically where it switches from chloride going into the cell to chloride going out of the cell. And in this case, it's negative with respect to the resting membrane potential. So you're getting hyperpolarization under most conditions. But when you expose it to BDNF, here's the resting membrane potential. Now, so the reversal potential is positive with respect to the resting membrane potential. So now you're getting a depolarization in most conditions, okay? So it fundamentally shifts the way that the nervous system responds to GABA. In one case, you're getting hyperpolarization at most membrane potentials. In the other one, you're getting depolarization at most membrane potentials compared to the resting membrane potential, okay? So the reason for this is because look what's happening when you're exposing the slice to BDNF. You're losing KCC2 expression, okay? So when you lose KCC2 expression, you lose the ability to extrude chloride and the intracellular chloride concentration goes higher, all right? So if you're looking at this neuron, it has a lower intracellular chloride concentration. So the driving force for chloride to come into the cell is much stronger, okay? So you're going to get hyperpolarization at most potentials. Whereas in this case, the intracellular chloride concentration is going to be higher, okay? So now what can happen is that chloride can go out of the cell instead of into the cell, right? So now it's a negative charge leaving the cell, so that's depolarization. And at most potentials, that's going to cause a depolarization. So I like to use a graph like this to explain this, and this is always the way that I try to kind of understand what these changes are going to mean. So first of all, this accounts for all of the different major ions that you have channels for in neurons, okay? So we have calcium, we have sodium, bicarb, but we're not going to really talk about that right now, and potassium, and chloride. And here's the average everyday resting potential for a neuron, about minus 70, okay? So these are the reversal potentials for all of these ions, just using the Nernst equation, all right? So we almost always have very high extracellular sodium concentration, a very low extracellular potassium concentration, but a very high intracellular potassium concentration, right? High extracellular calcium compared to inside the cell where it's very, very low. And then chloride is actually fairly variable. All right, so if this is the resting membrane potential and you open a potassium channel, what happens? Well, you move the potential of the cell close to the reversal potential for potassium, right? So with potassium, there's a very high intracellular concentration, a very low extracellular concentration, and what happens is you have the positive charge leaving the cell, right? Because that's the gradient. So the basis of moving from the resting membrane potential towards the reversal potential for potassium is potassium leaving the cell, right? Causing that hyperpolarization. All right, so there are really no circumstances where the reversal potential of potassium is going to change very much. So essentially under every physiological situation that you can dream up, what you're going to get is a strong hyperpolarization when you open potassium channels, okay? And in fact, you guys know this because if you think about the physiological basis of the action potential, right? The upshoot is sodium, the downshoot is mostly just sodium channels closing, and the after shoot is the potassium, right? That's when you're going down towards minus 100 millivolts. So sodium, we just mentioned, right? Sodium is even farther away from the resting membrane potential. This can change a little, maybe, but not very much. So if you open sodium channels, you're always going to get the same thing. You get depolarization. Always, 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 right? So, and if you open all the sodium channels, you'll eventually get to this reversal potential. But you won't go past it in most situations. Calcium is even farther away at plus 100, so you're, again, always going to get depolarization when you open these. And from the nervous system, you guys also know that opening voltage-gated calcium channels is a major mechanism through which you get neurotransmitter release, right? So the action potential gets you that depolarization that you need, and that always results in the same thing, influx of calcium that leads to the neurotransmitter release, right? The thing that is different, fundamentally different about chloride, which is the other major ion that you have channels for, is that it's not far away from the resting membrane potential, the reversal potential. And the intracellular concentration of chloride is actually very flexible because neurons can change it by changing the expression of either NKCC1 or KCC2. All right. So if the reversal potential for chloride is negative with respect to the resting membrane potential, what is almost always happening is that you have a lot of KCC2 and relatively less NKCC1, right? So this is the situation where you have 8 to 10 millimolar intracellular chloride. So it turns out that most cells in your body actually don't maintain that low level intracellular chloride concentration. It's just CNS neurons that do this, right? So they have a very low level of intracellular chloride, and that's the basis of this hyperpolarization, right? So when you open these channels, what happens is you move the resting membrane potential towards that reversal potential, right? So moving the resting membrane potential causes a hyperpolarization, and that happens because chloride is coming into the cell, right? Now, if you don't have KCC2 expression and do have NKCC1 expression, now you would have a high level of intracellular chloride. So you just plug these numbers into the Nernst equation. Let's say it's like plus 40, right? So that would give you a reversal potential close to around minus 40. So when you open these, you actually get a fairly big depolarization. Because again, it's just the same thing. You move the resting membrane potential towards the reversal potential for the ion channel that you're opening. Okay? It's just in this case, you have a high level of intracellular chloride. And that comes from having a lot of NKCC1 expression. So what does this all boil down to? Well, in the adult nervous system, the healthy adult nervous system, almost any neuron that you look at is going to have a lot of KCC2 expression and is going to show hyperpolarization in response to either GABA or glycine. But dorsal root ganglion neurons are fundamentally different. They don't express KCC2, and they do express it in KCC1, and if you expose them to GABA or glycine, you will very rarely, if ever, see a hyperpolarization. You will almost always get a depolarization. So let's go back now. Actually, let's explain a little bit more about the developmental shift, and then we'll come back to the theory. All right. So here's more about the in human beings when these things change in expression. So again, note with KCC2, which is in like light purple here, that very early development, there's hardly any expression at all. So this is when these neurons are showing GABAergic depolarization. And in fact, this GABAergic depolarization is critical for the development of these neurons because they need a cue that can get them a signal that they found the connection, right? And inhibitory signals don't lead to signaling, right? But robust depolarizing signals do lead to signaling. How do they do that? They lead to calcium influx, right? So it leads to activation of voltage-gated calcium channels and calcium influx, and that's a crucial signal for these cells to know that they made connections, right? Once they've started to make these connections, KCC2 expression comes up, and then it's hopefully maintained like that, and that's what gets you very strong inhibition. But you can lose this inhibitory efficacy by losing KCC2 expression. So we're going to talk about that in a lot of detail on Thursday. This again is just summarizing the major transporters, and the key ones are the NKCC1 and KCC2. Right? So NKCC1 imports chloride, KCC2 exports chloride. All right, so again, in DRG neurons, unlike almost every other neuron in the central nervous system, they don't express KCC2. I'm not aware of a single circumstance under which they express KCC2. So GABA is almost always depolarized. And that is the basis of this observation that was made in the 1950s, that primary afferent depolarization leads to this presynaptic inhibition that you get in the spinal cord. Okay? So it's depolarizing, but it's not depolarizing enough to cause excitation. Okay? It causes a shunting inhibition. What can happen, though, is that you can generate what are called dorsal root reflexes. And these dorsal root reflexes may have their emergence occur because of changes in NKCC1 expression or function. So NKCC1 can be phosphorylated, its expression can go up, and it can lead to the even more accumulation of chloride in these neurons. And if the chloride accumulation gets above a certain level, then if we go back to this slide, right? So if we take this all the way up to here, which you can do if you get like 50 millimolar chloride, and action potential threshold is here, right? Now you're going to be leading to not a small depolarization, but a large depolarization, which is enough to cause the neuron to fire action potentials. Right? So that's the idea of dorsal root reflexes. So that can now turn this GABAergic inhibition into excitation and generation of action potentials. So if we go back to this, this would be what's happening in this situation, right? So NKCC1 expression goes up. That now gives access from the C fiber to the A-beta fiber to the C fiber through these GABAergic neurons, right? So when you activate those GABAergic neurons, which happens all the time when you activate A-beta fibers, instead of causing inhibition, it actually activates the C fibers. So the result of that is, theoretically, touch evoked pain, right? So now you get you brush your skin in an area where you have neuropathic pain. It causes you pain. The A-beta fibers send a signal to the spinal cord. That itself is not painful, right? Because that doesn't get access to the C fibers. You're not actually activating the C fibers in the periphery. Those GABAergic neurons get excited like they would under any other circumstance. But this change in the way the GABA is handled by the C fibers, because they have a higher intracellular chloride concentration, causes them to be activated. And that's how you gain access to the pain channel, okay? So, and that's again just summarized here, right? So increase in KCC1, more chloride, bigger depolarization gives you access to the channel. And summarized again here. All right, so the question is, does this actually happen, right? So I actually spent my postdoc, or part of my postdoc, working on this question. We had some evidence that it could happen under certain circumstances. We had additional evidence that in neuropathic pain, it didn't really seem to work, okay? So other groups have continued to work on this, and again, I think shown pretty consistent results to what we saw, and that is that in certain inflammatory conditions, this does seem to lead to touch evoked pain, but in neuropathic pain, it doesn't really explain it, okay? So for me, this was really kind of unsatisfactory because what I really wanted to be able to explain is why does this happen with neuropathic pain, right? And we never produced a very good example of that. What we did come up with, though, was that it was pretty clear in certain inflammatory conditions that this was occurring, and it was driven by NKCC1. And the cool thing about that is that there's a drug that targets NKCC1 that has been used for decades. That drug is bumetanide. So bumetanide was actually one of the first diuretics that was invented. There's a lot of these chloride transporters in your kidney because that's actually how you make urine, okay, is by using these transporters. So when you guys get to medical school, this will be easily the most enjoyable lectures that you have, is your kidney function stuff. You're not laughing now, but you will be one day. Because it's not fun, but you have to learn it. So bumetanide targets these NKCC transporters, and we had this idea that we could take this drug that was already out there and very safe and used as a diuretic and potentially inhibit some of this touch of oak pain that happens in certain types of inflammation. And it turned out that this actually worked very well for visceral inflammation. So we thought it could be a good therapeutic. So the problem with that is that bumetanide actually does not cross the blood-brain barrier very well. And all of this is happening on the other side of the blood-brain barrier, right? So we were never really able to address this, but a company did spring up a couple years ago that I was an advisor for that made a prodrug of bumetanide. It was really a very, very clever concept. So they made a version of bumetanide that could get across the blood-brain barrier, but it wasn't active. Until it was cleaved by esterases. So it wouldn't act as a diuretic, which is good because most people don't want diuresis under normal circumstances. And it could get across the blood-brain barrier. So their concept was that this could be a drug that could be used for touch evoked pain in certain circumstances. Unfortunately, they never really got anywhere. So it still is not an idea that has been tested very rigorously, but you know, it's still out there. There's still some people that are working on this. So it could eventually come about. All right, so I'm going to stop there for today. Yeah, and just want to wrap up by saying that this idea probably does play a role in inflammatory pain, but again, does not really explain what happens in neuropathic pain. So why did we go through all this? We went through it because we're now going to talk about neuropathic pain on Thursday. We're going to focus on KCC2 and loss of KCC2 and how this can be involved in touch-evoked pain and neuropathic pain. But there's no way to understand this unless you understand the details of the chloride handling, right? So the nice thing about this story is it's a very good intro to the chloride handling and the general concepts of that. So between today's lecture and the lecture on Thursday, try to really grasp the concept of the chloride regulation because it's the key to what we're going to talk about on Thursday. Okay, hopefully the intro from today is sufficient to get you guys to that. And also take a look at the gliogenic LTP paper that I'll post on e-learning when I get back to my office. All right, any questions on the lecture today? Yes. So the question is there a neurotransmitter that starts as inhibitory but then becomes excitatory? So kind of the opposite of what you get with GABA. Like, I'm not aware of that. But the reason for it is explained in this slide. So all of these ion channels conduct a limited number of ions, right? So your options are sodium, calcium, potassium, and chloride. So if you just use the Nernst equation, which everybody in this room, if you haven't already memorized it, you should memorize it, okay? Because it's fundamentally important, and it explains just about everything, okay? And you can know the Goldman equation too, but that's just the modification of the Nernst equation, right? All right, so if you just think about how it works, what you're asking, which is a good question, is basically impossible, right? So if you're going to take, let's say, a sodium or calcium channel and change it from being depolarizing to inhibitory, you would have to so dramatically change the intracellular or extracellular concentrations of sodium or calcium that you know, let's just say you did it with calcium, right? You would have to change the intracellular calcium concentrations to such a high level that a very simple physiological experiment would show you that that calcium concentration is going to cause excitotoxic death to the neuron, okay? If you just play around with sodium concentrations and change the extracellular sodium concentration, for instance, to make it so that's actually possible, you just know, I mean, the system would just die. The cells would actually probably just pop because they would change their, they'd either shrink or grow so dramatically from the osmotic stress, right? So the only ion that really allows for this kind of change is chloride. And it's just simply because under most circumstances for the intracellular concentration, it's sitting so close to the resting membrane potential. The other way you could do it is design a cellular system where the resting membrane potential was extraordinarily positive, right? But we know cells like that don't exist. So maybe on another planet, but not on this one. Any other questions? All righty. See everybody on Thursday.